fine the Dinesh, introduction. As you heard, I am a cardiologist. I worked in All India Institute of Medical Sciences for 45 years. I retired from there. Now I am in another super specialty hospital back in Delhi called Gangaram Hospital. But apart from being a cardiologist, which I am, we do all angioplasties, bypasses, I have also been interested in Preksha meditation and yoga for the last about 20 years. I did a lot of research, which has been published also, which showed that Preksha meditation and yoga has the power even to reverse heart disease. And we are regularly having a reversal of heart disease camps back in India. Those of you who go to India should visit Adhyatmik Sadhana Kendra in Chhatarpur, Mehroli. And this is a branch of JVB, Jain Vishwa Bharati, which is headquarters are in Ladnu. And a lot of research is being done there. And that place has been renovated. You know, Chaturmas was there of Sharmanji, and it has been renovated. Those of you really who want to learn Preksha meditation, I will suggest you should come and spend 6 days there. We have a 6 days camp there going on for reversal of heart disease, prevention of heart disease. Anybody can join it. If you don't have heart disease, that's the best, or diabetes, that's the best. But if you have it, it can be controlled, as I will show you that it is possible to control many things with Preksha meditation. This is all research based. Last week, I think some of you were there, so I wish to be excused because some of it will be reputation, but much of it will be on our research that we are doing in Delhi itself. So my talk today is that Preksha meditation has the power to even reverse heart disease. Before I talked about the effect of Preksha meditation, I think one should know the magnitude of the problem. This is the total number of people who died in 2005. You can see that 58 million, out of which the leading cause is the cardiac cause. So about 30% of people throughout the world die from heart disease. So this is the leading cause of death all over the world. And this is followed by communicable disease, etc. So the same thing is true in India also. So this is the leading cause. Even in India, you can see 28 to 30% of people are dying of heart disease. We have the double burden, the communicable diseases. You see there 36%, they have not disappeared, but we have also got this. And what is happening is that in India, the disease is increasing. And in Indians, the disease is very prevalent. Whereas in many countries of the world, like the United States and any European countries, it has markedly come down. So this is a disease really of the developing countries. India and China are supposed to have 80% of people who will be having heart disease. So this is no more, concern of the Western countries, but it's a big concern for the Indians, because India is not only in India where the disease is increasing, even those who are settled in UK and other places, immigrants, they have the highest heart disease. This is the data from India. It's very clear that heart disease is increasing. You can see from 1960 to 95, it has increased 5 times in the urban population. In the rural population, much less. There also it's increasing. Actually, this is a disease no more of the rich people. This has already come from the rich people to the middle class people in India and in the Western countries, in Europe and in the United States. It's a disease of the poor people now. It's a disease of the, it's not a disease of the rich people anymore, because rich people are able to adjust. They can change their lifestyle. They know diet, they can adjust, they can do exercise, they can stop smoking. But the poor people cannot change their lifestyle, or they are not even informed. So it is a disease of the poor people. Two things are clear. One is that this is a disease which occurs more in the urban population. As we go to the cities, we get more disease, and in the rural population much less. But and it's increasing very rapidly, and it's a very costly disease. As I said, it is now occurring in the super developing countries, and you can see that the amount of money that India had to spend on diseases which are similar, their lifestyle diseases like heart disease, diabetes and stroke, in 10 years it's $236 billion. This is only next to Russian Federation, but look at United Kingdom and Canada as compared to these two countries. the number of patients is so large that we have to spend quite a lot. And this is what is projected going to happen in year 2040. That the disease is going to increase in the developing countries. This is Brazil here, 250%. China will increase 200%. India will increase 170%. Already, as I said, this is a very common disease. It is already killing about 2.5 million Indians. That means 25 lakhs. That means 5 people die every minute. And that this disease occurs at a relatively younger age. Younger age means less than 40 years. We get to about 30% of people. And in the Western countries, it is in the older age group. Secondly, it is likely to be more fatal in Indians. They have very high mortality. And Indians who are settled abroad, as I said, even in UK, the Indian immigrants have much higher heart disease as compared to any other immigrant, whether they are Chinese, whether they are even Singapore. Indians have 6 times more heart disease as compared to the Malay and the Chinese people. So Indians, for some reason, are most prone to get this disease. And what is this disease? This disease is what is called as coronary heart disease. This disease occurs because of deposition of cholesterol. It's a wax-like material that deposits in the coronary arteries. You know, the heart is a very small structure. Only 300 grams it supplies. It is supplied by two arteries, one on the left side and two on the one on the right side, two on the left side. Now these coronary arteries get deposits of this cholesterol, and this is a coronary artery which has been shown in a high magnificent. You can see in a child there is no deposition of cholesterol. If we have this type of artery, we will not get heart disease at all. But at the age of 10 or 15 years, you can see small deposits of fat start appearing. They are reversible. We have shown it. I will show you some of the data that it's possible to reverse this with preksha meditation and yoga. If we do, if we are not careful, then this goes on increasing. And when the blockage is more than 70% here, we start getting pain in the chest on walking or breathlessness on walking. That's called angina. Angina means our arteries are blocked more than 70%. And when the artery gets blocked 100%, then we get what is called heart attack, which can be fatal also. So this is a disease. Now, why does this start occurring? There are some risk factors which we have which cause this. And this is our lifestyle factors. Our diet is not healthy. If we don't exercise, if we smoke, and if we are under stress, these are the four factors really which cause it. And all these factors cause high blood pressure, diabetes, etc., which is a very strong risk factors. So these are the risk factors for heart disease. They are very simple. For example, a diet, unhealthy diet can cause high cholesterol. High cholesterol is also called dyslipidemia. This is a very common problem in India and throughout the world. About 60% of people suffer from this high cholesterol. And this is because of unhealthy diet. The diet which is high in cholesterol should be avoided. For example, the eggs, the meat, and the cream of the milk. It's been shown that vegetarians have less heart disease because of several factors. One is their cholesterol is lower, and then fruits and vegetables have several phytochemicals. They reduce the cholesterol and so on. So if we have a proper diet, which is a low fat diet, we should not take fried things. Indians are very fond of taking these fried food, etc. That's a very important risk factor. Secondly, the type of oil that we use is also very unhealthy. We use many times these fast foods are using hydrogenated oils, which are very high in trans fats. So trans fats are really poison, and similarly high saturated fats are bad. So one should use a good oil, and the best oil which is considered is either mustard oil or rapeseed. You use rapeseed oil. Isn't it?
Yes, good.
Yeah. Reason, olive oil is good.
Oil, it's better than olive oil. We always say because olive oil has very little omega-3. Olive oil has 0.5%, but rapeseed and mustard oil have 10%. So I would say mustard oil, rapeseed is 20 times better than olive oil. Although olive oil is also good, I'm not saying that's a bad oil. That's a pretty good oil. But if you see the omega-3, that's there's a big study done from India that people who use mustard oil, they have 70% less heart attacks. This is published in a very important journal of American Journal of Clinical Nutrition. So people who use mustard oil in their cooking, they have 70% less heart attack as compared to sunflower, which is also good oil. So I would suggest that this is the best oil, because omega-3 is very beneficial. You all of you know, all of you take flax seeds and so many other things which are really in the market. So that is the best oil. We should take lots of fruits and vegetables. One of the main reasons why Indian gets heart disease is we do not take enough fruits and vegetables. If we take 3 or 4 times fruits and vegetables, we have less hypertension, we have less heart disease, we have less diabetes also, and less cancer. So all these things are related to the diet. Similarly, we should take low salt. If we cut 25% salt in our diet, then the blood pressure will come down and all the complications will come down. Similarly, these sugar should be avoided. Drinks, aerated drinks, they are very dangerous actually. A lot of reports now that so-called energy drinks which we take have a lot of sugar, and they are also very dangerous. They all cause diabetes and metabolic syndrome. So one should take a diet which is rich in fruits and vegetables, low in fat, preferably a good oil like a mustard oil or canola oil or grapeseed oil. And canola is also a rapeseed oil, really, coming from Canada. And one should use less of salt and less of sugar. This is now recommended in the various guidelines which are available. Diet is also responsible for hypertension. If we take too much of salt, then this disease occurs, which is the commonest disease in the world. Every third adult in this world is suffering from this disease. And as the age advances, the high blood pressure becomes more. For example, at 60 years, it's 60%, 70, and at 80, it is 80%. So everybody practically suffers from this disease. But this can be stopped if we take less salt and less fat in our diet. Similarly, diabetes, we are the diabetic capital. Actually, Indians have the highest diabetes in the world. In India, the number of people who are suffering from diabetes is very large. It's roughly 5 crores, and the number is going to increase 300% next 20 years unless we are careful about it. And this is also related to the diet. The diet which is rich in refined foods. Indians are very fond of taking it. There are 4 things which have been refined, which all have been related to diabetes. For example, the wheat has been refined into so-called maida, or refined flour. So anything, this white bread is very dangerous. There's data to show that it can cause diabetes. Similarly, all these noodles, etc., which are made of that refined flour are not good. So don't use maida at all. Indians are very fond of taking puris and other things. So the second thing which has been refined is the gur, jaggery, what we call it. It's made into sugar. Sugar is dangerous because we take a lot of sweets, etc. Sweets are doubly dangerous because not only they have sweets, they have sugar, but they have also saturated fats and many of them, trans fats also. So the third thing which has been refined is the oil. It's best to take a non-refined oil, which is called extra virgin olive oil. You might have seen that. Extra virgin is nothing but cold compressed. It's going in India, we get this kachi ghani ka mustard oil. These only 2 oils are available. They are cold compressed. But many of the oils in the organic shops, I was taking it up yesterday here, they are so-called cold compressed. So best is to take non-refined oils. Non-refined means refining spoils the oil, because they have to heat it at a very high temperature, about 200 plus, which destroys all the good things, and then we have to add some chemicals to deodorize it. And that's why it's best to use that. And so the fourth thing which has been refined is the rice. One should not take polished rice. This basmati rice is no good. You should take brown rice. Brown rice, or I was looking here, red rice is available here, which is extremely good because red rice has been shown to decrease cholesterol also. So we should avoid refined things, and we Indians take a lot of these refined, especially sweets, etc. And that's why I think Indians are most prone to that. Of course, we also take a lot of trans fats, etc., which may be responsible. And the fourth thing is obesity. It is the commonest problem in the world now. In the United States, now 50% of Americans are overweight or obese. Even in UK, the data is that people are going to be obese 50% in the next 10 or 20 years unless steps are taken. And even in India, we have done a study in schools, 25% of the public schools, the children are obese. Now this will basically, you know. This obesity is associated with high cholesterol, high blood pressure, diabetes, and so many other things. A very common sleep disorder called obstructive sleep apnea, which is very, very common, which is a risk factor for this. So obesity is a very dangerous thing. In Indians, the weight may not be too much. We have central obesity. We have our waist size is much more than what is it. And that's also very dangerous because this central obesity, this fat is very, very dangerous. It releases all the things which damage our body, can cause diabetes and diabetes. It's called metabolic syndrome. So this may be one reason why Indians have it, because we all are prone to get so-called metabolic syndrome. In this conference which we are having now in London itself, this is the European Society of Cardiology, we are having an Indian session in which we are going to talk about metabolic, why Indians get so much of diabetes and heart disease. One of the reasons we are trying to tell them is we have central obesity. Mm-hmm. We may not be overweight.
So how do we avoid that?
Again, by healthy lifestyle, it's very simple. Good diet, exercise.
I've known a lot of people.
We'll show you. We will show you. Even Riksha meditation helps. We have done study on that. This is metabolic syndrome. So, I think diet is the most important part. It can cause diabetes, it can cause all these things which are responsible for heart failure. You all know that high cholesterol causes hypertension, causes. Hypertension not only causes heart attacks but also causes strokes, which are very, very dangerous, damages the kidney and so on. And diabetes damages almost every organ that we know. Not only is the most important cause for heart attacks or heart disease, but also responsible for eye problem and for blockage of the various arteries and so on. Diabetes is really not a disease of the sugar, I must tell you. It's a heart disease, because most of the people don't die of high blood sugar, they die of heart disease. More than 70% of people die of heart attack. So diabetes and heart disease are quite closely related. So whatever I'm going to tell for heart disease is applicable to this diabetes also, and hypertension. The second factor apart from the diet is lack of exercise. Everybody knows that exercise is very good, but unfortunately very few people do it. And this is because this is where I think yoga helps, Preksha meditation helps, because we have no control over mind. I ask my patients, you know, exercise, why don't you do exercise? He said, doctor, I get up in the morning, but my mind says, don't go today. You had a late night. You know, it's snowing today, it's raining. In India, it doesn't snow, but it's at least raining. So don't go today, tomorrow you can go. But that tomorrow never comes. The mind makes. So we are slaves of the mind. What we did was, our patients, when we teach them Riksha meditation, then they make up their mind. When they get up, the mind says the same thing, they shut up. He will go to the walk. And the mind stops interfering, you see. You should not be slaves of the mind, you should be master. And the only way to become master is by doing yoga and meditation. Because it is to make the mind strong. And the heart disease really starts from the mind, I can tell you that. Because mind creates thoughts. Whatever our thoughts are, we do that. My thought is to exercise, I will exercise, I will not exercise. My thought is to eat this food which is full of fats, etc. I know it's bad, but I'm slave of the mind. Similarly, my mind says, don't go for a walk, don't start smoking. I ask my patient, why do you smoke? He says, my mind says one or two cigarettes, nothing going to happen. They don't know where to stop. And so I think exercise is very, very important, and exercise decreases our weight. You know, it burns calories, it controls our diabetes, it controls our metabolic syndrome, can also be controlled. High blood pressure can be controlled, and it prevents the clotting of the blood. So a lack of exercise is one of the 10 leading causes of mankind. If you don't do exercise, you are very high to die because of either heart disease or so many other diseases. And exercise is not only good for the heart, it's good for the whole body, for the lungs, for the joints. And that's why it's rightly said that regular exercise not only adds life to years, but puts life into years. In other words, we always remain young if we are doing exercise. So exercise is important. Any exercise is good. It can be walking for half an hour to 45, it can be cycling, it can be swimming, and it should be done every day, 7 days a week. I don't like this term, 5 days a week, because this has been said by many Western people. I said, what do you do for the rest 2 days? He said, we relax. This means exercise is stress for you. 5 days, if you are doing exercise as a stress, it doesn't give you any benefit. So whatever you like, what relaxes you should do it every day. So I always say 7 days a week. And there's a lot of data that people who exercise, they are not only their weight is proper, but they also have less heart disease. Mental stress, I think one of the most important, which has been neglected for a long period of time, is one of the most important causes of heart disease, diabetes, as well as high blood pressure. This is coming to prominence now recently. There was a very big study done by an Indian who settled in Canada, Dr. Salim Yusuf, you know, the best researchers in cardiology throughout the world. And he trying to find out why heart attacks occur in 52 countries all over the world, including India, Asia, Europe, America, Canada. And they found that mental stress, psychosocial stress, is one of the most important factors which is present. It comes only next to tobacco. And this is the most difficult thing to control, because people, whether they are in US or in UK, I'm sure most of you have stress. Anybody who doesn't have stress here? Hollywood, it's all stress. And, I'll tell you, in yoga we say there's nothing called stress. We create stress ourselves. There's nothing. Life is not a straight line. In yoga we reksha meditates like waves of an ocean. Happiness and unhappiness. When unhappiness occurs, we always say, why to me? And we don't accept it. And secondly, we think negative. That now this thing has happened, it's not going to improve. People who are doing yoga, they always think this is normal and the wave which has come down will come up, and they think positive. So that's what breaksha meditation is. So mental stress is very easy. That's why you know that yoga and meditation has become an international practice. On 21st June, there was International Day of Yoga. And thanks to our Prime Minister, Mr. Modi, who really brought it to the notice of the whole world. And on that day, the whole world celebrated. And the reason why yoga was accepted is because scientifically it has been shown this is the only method if you want to lead a happy and a stress-free life. Everybody wants to lead a happy life, isn't it? We're looking for happiness outside. A big car, if I have got, I'll be happy. If I have a big house, but the moment the car has an accident, I'm unhappy. The external things are temporary happiness. But happiness is right inside us, and that's what yoga gives. And a lot of studies are there that people who are doing regularly yoga, they are really happy all the time. They're happy and they're stress-free. That's why it's becoming popular all over the world. Because this is the only method of leading a stress-free and a happy life. So mental stress should be controlled, because mental stress can cause so many diseases. Headache, for example. Headache is never because of high blood pressure. High blood pressure is silent. And severe form of headache, migraine, is there. All because of stress. And stress can cause lots of other high blood pressure, diabetes, as I said. It can cause heart disease, as I told you, it can cause psychoneurotic disease like anxiety, like depression, etc. And then, of course, finally is the tobacco consumption. This is all types of tobacco is bad, whether we are smoking cigarettes, BDs, actually BDs are much worse, or chewing tobacco. Most of the world smoking has come down, especially in the United States. But it's unfortunate that in Indians, tobacco consumption is increasing, especially those chewing tobacco, and Zarda Pan Masala is becoming more popular if you go by the sales of these things. So tobacco is very, very dangerous. Everybody knows it causes cancer. It's very unfortunate that in India, in Indians, you know, the throat cancer is the maximum because we chew tobacco. And everybody knows it causes cancer, but very few people know that it is one of the main risk factors for heart disease. And it causes heart disease at a young age. I have seen heart attacks occurring at the age of 25 or 30 years. And one of the main reasons is this tobacco. So tobacco is one of the biggest enemies of mankind. It's killing in India at least 2 persons every minute, 10 lakhs people die. And this can also be controlled by meditation. And yoga and breaksha meditation can control all these risk factors. And there's a lot of data on each one of these factors, that cholesterol can be controlled, hypertension, diabetes, obesity. People start doing exercise, the compliance, as I said, the mind is in their control, mental stress is reduced, and tobacco consumption can also be stopped. So there's a lot of scientific evidence, but we will show you that it can really reverse the heart disease also. Now, what is yoga? Yoga, a word has been taken from a Sanskrit word called yuj. Yuj means union, uniting your mind with the body. You see, our mind is somewhere else and body is somewhere else. See, when we get up in the morning, first thing is we have to go for a walk. We are not enjoying the morning cup of tea or anything. We just want to rush to the park. The moment we are in the park, we go for a walk. I'm telling you, many of the Indians who do that, their mind is not in their walk. They want to come back. I have to go back. And when you come back, I have to take my breakfast. They're not enjoying the breakfast. I have to go and reach my office. And once they reach the office, then they want to come back home. I don't know when it will finish. So and this is what yoga gives you, that uniting your mind with the body. And that's where meditation is really all about. Whatever we are doing, it's called mindfulness meditation. We should be aware of what we are doing. We should enjoy that. And staying in the present is meditation. We are either in the past or the future. So our efficiency is reduced markedly. If staying in the past, we reduce 30%, in the future 30%, we are left with only 30%. That also, a lot of emotions are there, attachments are there, and we reduce it. So we are not working efficiently at all. This has been shown people in the yoga, their efficiency increases. Anyhow, so yoga means uniting your mind with the body. And this is very, very important, because once you unite the mind with your body, then the mind becomes your friend. Actually, it's our enemy these days. Because when we want to do something, the mind says, don't do this thing. Anything we want to do good, like I told you, you want to go for a walk, the mind says, don't go today. It's making an excuse, because we have not developed friendship with that. The other union is yourself with the higher self. You see, now doctors also agree, we are not the body, we have the mind and consciousness, or the spirit. So it is combining your spirit with a higher spirit and all. So this is the whole idea. Earlier it was always people used to, wanted to, reach God, and this was a method of reaching your consciousness to the higher consciousness. But these days it has become only mind with the body. So it is an integrated system of self culture, aims at harmonious development of body mind, covers all aspects of human life, leading to physical well-being, mental harmony, culminating into positive things, happiness and peace. This is the whole idea of life. We want to think positive, we want to be happy, we want to be in peace. And there are a lot of data to show that it is possible to do that. It is a practical universalism. That's why it's been accepted all over the world. It is irrespective of your religion or anything like that. So, irrespective of culture, nationality, race, caste, or religion. And even physical condition, even people who cannot, when I was doing my research, many patients said, doctor, I cannot do this yoga because I cannot sit on the floor. Because the things, if you can't sit, you can't do yoga. I said, you don't have to sit. We did 50% of patients sitting on the chair. They had osteoarthritis, they had knee replacement. They couldn't sit on the floor, but sitting on the chair, there was equally beneficial. So, irrespective of your physical condition, you can do it. Many of the things you can do. Meditation can be done, pranayama, etc. can be done. It can be practiced at individual or group level. The best is in the group level. I would suggest that at least in summer days, you can form a group and start doing yoga, etc. In Delhi, where I stay, in our park, of course, we can do in the park throughout the year. We have 70 people are doing yoga every day, 6 to 7. In a group, it's always much better. I know of many other places in Delhi and in India where the weather is not good and they do the basement or somebody's house and all. So if few people combine, it really becomes extremely good, because it's extremely good for social well-being also. So it can be, it has been practiced in schools, even in prisons. Prisoners have improved, and of course corporates is being done to improve their efficiency. A lot of studies have done which shows that if officers before starting their work do for half an hour of meditation, then their efficiency improves, the absentees are less, there's less fights and so on. So people come out, there's a lot of data. Therefore, yoga should be called as the lifestyle, which consists of physical, mental, emotional, spiritual well-being. Actually, this is the best lifestyle ever devised. These are the components of yoga or preksha meditation. That it has four components. The physical component, which all doctors agree. I told you, a healthy diet. Sattvic diet is suggested. Sattvic diet is also vegetarian and a high fiber, low fat diet. So we should take a diet which is, and they always advocate that we should take less salt and less sugar. The sugar was not there when, of course, yoga was described 5,000 years earlier. So sugar was not there. So exactly the diet which we are telling today, scientifically, has been a part of yoga. And physical exercise is a part of yoga, and no addictions like tobacco. So physically, I think everybody agrees that we should do these things. But I think the most important part of yoga or Diksha meditation is mental well-being. And this is achieved by meditation. There are a large number of techniques of stress management. Any technique you take, there are hundreds of them, whether it's an American system or a Chinese system, they are all based on some yogic discipline out here. And it is accepted that yoga is the best method, or meditation is the best method of stress management. Even in China, it is very, very popular. Huge number of centers are there. And although they have their own systems, but they are still going for yoga because they think this is the only method which can give them happiness and peace. So mental well-being is very important. That emotional well-being is the most important part of yoga. We all know that this anger, ego, jealousy, hostility, kaam, krodh, moha, ahankar, these are our enemies, but all of us have them. We have anger, we have ego, we have jealousy, we have hostility. If we have these diseases, we can get several diseases. Anger has, I have seen anger causing heart attacks. I have seen anger causing cardiac arrest, ventricular fibrillation. If people get really too much. Ego is our big problem. We think we are better than others. So humility, if we have the disease of muscle, people who are egoistic, who have ego, they have more heart disease. Similarly, jealousy, hostility. The positive emotion it inculcates, like compassion, humility, and loving. So all these positive emotions now have been shown to cause happiness and peace, and we are free from disease also. And this is very difficult to control anger. Wise, so to see patients with heart attacks, I tell them, you should not get angry now, you got a heart attack, you got an angioplasty now. He says, yes, I will not. But the moment he goes home or in the office, he cannot control. So the only way to control anger is to go on doing some yoga meditation, and you will see after a few days or months, it's a practical discipline. Yoga meditation is not a theoretical discipline. It's just like physical exercise. If I know exercise is good, it's not going to help me. I may know every detail of exercise. I have to do it to be better. Similarly, I may know meditation is good, yoga is good. Unless I do it, then it's a practical discipline. So if you want to be emotionally healthy, you should really practice. And then the spiritual component is important, because now even doctors are realizing that people who are spiritual, means just going to temple, just going to church or mosques, these people have less heart disease. They have they recover quickly from this, and a lot of these moral values, if they are inculcated, a lot of these bad things which are happening, like even violence, etc., terrorism also can come down. So being spiritually healthy, so this is yoga lifestyle, which is all components of health. You see, health has been defined by WHO not as mere absence of disease or infirmity, but a state of physical, mental, and spiritual well-being. So if we want to be really healthy, we have to follow yoga, because physically we may be healthy. The modern science which I practice also gives us physically healthy, but if we want to be mentally and emotionally healthy, then we have to add yoga. And that's why many institutions are now accepting this. This is called integrated medicine, in which you combine the ancient system, ancient wisdom with the modern medicine. Even in England, there are several hospitals of integrated medicine. I'm told there's a Royal Hospital of Integrated Medicine here, which was inaugurated by Prince Charles. So everybody has started believing in it now. And this is what spirituality is. There is some data to show that people who go to church regularly or temple, they live longer, 8 years longer. This is a study of 100, this analysis of 150 studies done over 100,000 patients all over the world, and they live longer. This is the data again in various journals. And there's also suggestion that heart disease is less, and recovery from acute illnesses. Prayers and music program reduce the mortality. If you pray for somebody who is in the serious ICU or CCU, you will find that the recovery is quicker. There are a lot of studies, and 40 studies on prayers. Not only pray for yourself, but pray for somebody else. It is reported in that. And similarly, the music programs, all these mantras that we chant, Gayatri mantra, Om chanting, a huge number of things. These are all scientific things now. It's coming that it also improves and all. And of course, even if you have laughter is the best medicine. If you can laugh all the time, which is a part of yoga again, that also reduces. That's why You can see that many of the international American these magazines like Newsweek have started bringing out special issues. Is religion a good medicine? Why science is starting to believe in religion? There's several articles which have appeared that even being spiritual person makes you much healthier. And this is what happens during meditation. There have been functional MRI imagings done of the brain. You can see that these are in the nuns who are doing meditation. And you can see that during meditation, the areas in the brain where concentration is there are enhanced. And wherever ego, etc. is there, that decreases markedly. So we are not using more than 20% of brain. We are using only that portion of the brain where all the bad emotions are there, like anger. We have never used those areas. And there's scientific studies to show that when we do meditation for a period of time or prayers, those areas are ignited where we have peace and tranquility. We are able to concentrate more and we are much happier.
Hello, can you just go back?
Yes. Sure.
And just explain a little bit what changes happen when the meditations, before meditation and after meditation, what are the particular points which are affected?
You see, these are the areas. These are the areas which are used for concentration. You said that was hardly an activity. This is the area of concentration is markedly improved here. You can see this. This is the area which is of concentration, the frontal lobe, etc. So people have to concentrate work. That's why work efficiency improves and all. And there is a decreased activity where a sense of self is there. The ego goes. There is an increased activity. We have a lot of ego here, and that decreases here. You can see that it becomes red means increase, and during meditation has come down. This is just an example, but there's large number of studies available on functional MRI vision. If you click the internet, you will find this is just a small glimpse of that. Huge number of studies are there. Functional MRI imaging really shows that our brain activities change. And if we meditate for a long period of time, the brain becomes permanently like that. This means people said, how do we feel happy? And these are because certain areas which we are not using are sort of initiated, which were never being used earlier. So
okay.
That's...
Thank you.
Okay.
Yes, please.
Does it help in mental issues like dementia?
There is a small data. I will come to that in a minute when I tell other uses and all that thing. There are some studies in depression. There are a large number of studies. Anxiety, yes. Dementia, yes, it prevents Alzheimer's disease and all. But studies are very small. So I will not say once dementia has occurred, whether it will help or not. But it will surely prevent dementia. It's more preventive. There are no studies. There are studies in depression, there are studies in anxiety, there are studies in schizophrenia also. A number of studies have been done, but not in dementia really. Yeah, in presenile dementia, it has more preventive value. So, as a scientist, I won't say that it can cure dementia. No, I don't want to say that. But surely it can prevent, because dementia has due to several chemicals which are released and so on and so on. Anyhow, so therefore yoga is it is the best lifestyle. It's a intensive and holistic lifestyle which consists of all the things: stress management, healthy diet, regular physical exercise, avoidance of tobacco. And all these four factors have been shown to delay dementia or to prevent it. If you have a healthy diet, dementia occurs much later. If you exercise, it much occurs. And stress management is very important, and tobacco. All these four factors do it. And therefore we believe that it can prevent dementia. But once it occurs, then we don't know, but we will show. Actually, there are so many yogic disciplines or yoga methods that one is confused. Which should I follow? Sometimes Ramdev is there, sometimes Sri Sri Ravi Shankar is there, sometimes we have this Vipassana, we have transcendental meditation, we have all types of things are there. But they are all derived. Yoga was described 5,000 years earlier in the Vedas. And this, they described, Acharya Patanjali described 8 disciplines. These are the disciplines, yam, niyam. These are, but difficult, these are personal and social norms. You should not steal, you should not no greed, etc. is there, we should surrender, cleaning, all those things are, but they were a little difficult because yam niyam, so people modified it, you see. These spiritual masters, they said, let's not go this way. So they went to the other parts, like, then the third was asanas. Asana is a comfortable posture, not complicated. Standing on the head is not, a thousand is right. If you're sitting on the chair with a straight spine, with a straight back, that's also an asana. So a comfortable posture is asanas. It's not really difficult to, because even orthopedic people say that if you sit like that on a computer, you will get cervical. If you with a spine which is curved, you will get a back pain and so on. So asanas are nothing but comfortable postures, and there are now modified asanas also which are called stretching exercises. They're called swasvardhakriya. You might, we do it in preksha meditation. These are stretching exercises. These are called sukshma kriya also, they are called swasvardhakriya. Because many people who start yoga after the age of 60, 70 years cannot do these asanas, but they can do stretching exercises like for the neck, for the shoulders and so on, as I will show you. And then, so comfortable posture is yoga, because if you are not comfortable, if your joints are paining, you cannot really concentrate. And the next is pranayama, how to breathe properly. We all breathe wrongly, you see, that's what I learned from it. 99% of the patients said, doctor, we are breathing wrongly. When we breathe in, abdomen should come out, and when we breathe out, it should go in. So this is called abdominal, using diaphragm. And we know as doctors that you get 25% more oxygen if you are using diaphragm. So this is, we tell them how to breathe properly. That means when they breathe in, the abdomen should come out, and when they breathe out, it's abdominal breathing. We do it from the chest. And secondly, during pranayama, the breathing rate comes down. Normally we are breathing very fast, 18-20. During pranayama, it comes down to 8-10. Some people can bring it down to 4 after practice. Now, this is a very simple principle. When we are relaxed, the breathing is quiet. When we are sleeping, it is about 7-8. When we are under stress, it goes very quiet. If voluntarily we can slow it down, then the mind relaxes. There are studies to show that alpha waves start appearing in the brain. That means mind gets relaxed. So pranayama has a lot of advantages. And one should take deep breaths, and one should also...
Can you talk on pranayama?
Yes.
Someone said to me that you should do thoracic breathing, because the stomach is for digesting, and if you do thoracic breathing, the lungs get expanded.
That's wrong. No, there are three things in this breathing you must understand. There's something called diaphragm also. And diaphragm also should be used, because if you bring down the diaphragm completely, then the oxygen which goes is 25%. And then you have to really take the diaphragms up also. Only then to expel the foley. So it should not be thoracic. Even doctors don't say it should be thoracic. It is abdominothoracic. The chest is little, but mostly it is abdominal. That's what we tell you. You see, how do we teach that? First we say, use the word C. Like, many people don't know it, and press it here. Like this. Shh. Now it's gone in. And when I breathe in, so shh. Every time, you see, it's going in. And it becomes a habit over a period of time. So this is how we teach them, because we are not used to this type of breathing. If you see a child, it's abdominal breathing. We should be like a child if you want to do yoga. Even their posture, you know, what we call for relaxation, etc., is like a child. And all the asanas are done by children. So if you are like small children, a child smiles about 200 times a day. We smile once in 4 days. You be like a child. If you're smiling all the time, you will never get anything. Anyhow, so this is pranayama. There's so many types of pranayama. Now people are confused, hundreds of types. So you can pick up two or three, which will make you, this principle is this, that you should have a deep breathing, and secondly, you should have abdominal breathing, and you should, the rate should come down. And it relaxes you, there's enough data. Then you should know how to control sense, how to concentrate. There are different methods for that. And then you comes to meditation. And again, there are so many types of meditation, like preksha meditation, vipassana is there, and Raj Yoga is there, Ram Kumaris and all. Extremely good. Now, and then of course, you can samadhi, if you do for a long period of time, you can be a part of the universe. But up till meditation, everybody can. These are 7 steps. Now, there's different types of yoga which have, say, either stress more on asanas, for example, Iyengar yoga, it's extremely good. Iyengar mostly talks of asanas, he does talk of other things also. There's some people who talk of breathing much more, like Shri Ravi Shankar, Sudarshan Priya is there, Ramdev is also talking a lot about this thing. There are some people who are talking only of meditation, like you see Brahma Kumaris, they talk of Raj Yoga, transcendental meditation, they talk of only meditation. Similarly, is most popular in the United States these days is mindfulness meditation. It's a Buddhist system, that's also meditation. But you do any one of them, if you are starting after the age of 60, 70, best is to do all the three. And most of the people have used all these three. It's a few asanas for stretching exercises. This second is breathing, and third is meditation. If you go this way, you are able to meditate very easily, because meditation, some people think, is difficult. Although it's not difficult, I think if we have time, we can do it for 5 minutes after the lecture. And all. It's the simplest thing to do. There are so many types. So I think one should not get confused. One can adapt any system that you like. Whether you like Ramdev, whether you like anybody else, but this benefit is going to be the same. As a scientist, I can tell you we have analyzed the data of most of these type of meditations and yoga. The results are the same, as I will show you. So yoga has been claimed to be beneficial in many conditions, like control of anxiety, depression. I will not go into detail, but a lot of data is there that it's extremely good in depression, as good as the anti-depression drugs, and without any side effects and all. It's very good in bronchial asthma, it's very good in diabetes mellitus. A lot of data is there in bronchial asthma, international study done in Munger in India, you know, in Bihar. Munger is one of the best schools of yoga in the world. And they have done international study in bronchial asthma. Diabetes mellitus, similarly, huge number of studies are there, both from India as well as abroad. We have done even in metabolic syndrome at Wesley, I'll show you that. Then migraine, there are several studies. Physical fitness, extremely good. Most of the players who are playing cricket or hockey, etc., they are also being taught yoga, because you achieve mental concentration and you think positive. And of course, there are so many other conditions which has been, even in cancer, it has been used even in gastrointestinal problems like irritable bowel syndrome, ulcerative colitis. The list is endless, but we. Most important is that it is useful in cardiovascular disease, the diseases which we are talking of. The heart disease, it is very, very important. And it can control, so-called prevent the heart disease. There are several studies. One of them, the second one, has been done in India, in All India Institute when I was there, which showed that people who have no disease at all, but their cholesterol comes down, blood pressure comes down, blood sugar comes down, and even obesity comes down. Similarly, this is Kriya Yoga done in the United States. This is a 3 months residential course, and they also showed the same thing. All the risk factors which cause heart disease, like blood pressure, the cholesterol, the weight, and also the stress and smoking came down in both these groups and all. So if you do not have the disease, the best is to do this yoga. You will get the maximum advantage. All those bad things are removed. Even you don't have heart disease. So it's been proven that it's good for so-called primary prevention. And in hypertension, there are huge number of studies. And all. We have also done the Priksha meditation. And it was shown long back that Shavasana in India, one cardiologist, Dr. Date from Mumbai, showed in 1960s it can reduce blood pressure. Nobody believed him. But after that, now thousands of studies are there. And it has been shown that, yes, even Shavasana can reduce this blood pressure. And yoga is as effective as drugs in mild hypertension, for example, like beta blocker or calcium channel blockers, without any side effects at all. And the mechanism has also been studied. We reduce what is called as the sympathetic drive, all these catecholamines, etc., which are bad. They are reduced, and certain baroreceptor also changes. So the mechanism also has been studied. What I'm trying to say is, I have treated thousands of patients of hypertension who have mild hypertension. Say less than 160 by 100, they can be easily controlled by yoga and meditation. But yoga here, I'm meaning holistic. You have to control the diet, you have to stop smoking, you have to make them exercise, and you have to ask them to control stress by yoga. And this has been shown now in large number of studies. And recently, American Heart Association, this is the biggest cardiological society in the world, they have accepted that transcendental meditation has been shown to reduce blood pressure, should be used as a non-drug method, non-pharmacological method for controlling blood pressure. This is for the first time that such a big society really agrees that meditation is helpful in hypertension. So This has been shown very clearly, and I have practical experience. But I think yoga and praksha meditation is so strong that it can even reverse heart disease. If there are blocked arteries, it can really reverse them. And this is a study in metabolic syndrome. This is the patients who have central obesity, their tummy is bulging. Otherwise, they are healthy. They have slightly high blood sugar, slightly high blood pressure. They are healthy otherwise. But they have the central, they have so-called insulin resistance. These people are very likely to develop either diabetes or heart disease or both of them. So this is called metabolic syndrome. This is very common in Indians. 60 to 70% of Indians have it, either in India, even in the Western countries. Some of my colleagues in the UK have also shown. It's very, very common in Indians, that central obesity. If your waist size is more than, for Indians, the parameters are different. In males, if it's more than 36 inches, and in females, more than 32 inches, the waist size, then you are suffering from this disease called metabolic syndrome, because this disease can cause diabetes and heart disease, because there's insulin resistance. So these are the patients we took, and 1 year, half of them we taught praksha meditation, and half were by the usual methods. We told them that you should control the diet, exercise, and so on. And we found that there was a decrease in the blockage in the arteries. You see, initially in these people, the arteries are not blocked. It's only arteries are thickened. And this is the artery which is taken, called carotid artery. So carotid artery medial thickness was reduced, indicating that the early blockages have been reversed. And this we have reported also in many journals also. And I have a reprint. Last time also, I gave, those who are interested can really read this. So we showed that early blockages can be reversed completely, but if there is an advanced blockages, that is what we are interested in. Many of our patients are only aware when the blockages are more than 60-70%. There are 3 studies again utilizing yoga, and all of them, they are different methods. See, Dean Ornish from United States, you might be knowing, he was very famous. He called it lifestyle heart trial, because at that time yoga term was not accepted, but he used the a method of yoga from India, Shivananda Yoga, and he did that and showed in 40 patients that it's possible to reverse heart disease. But his program consisted of patients who were having 40% blockages, and his diet was vegetarian, means in a hotel they will give them some salad and fruits, and that's all vegetarian. It's not a very practical method. So we did the praksha meditation trial in 2000, which we reported. 96 we started, it took 4 years. And this is Yoga Life, which has been published also. And this is for the first time we use people more than 70% blockages. I will show you that details. But that's where what praksha meditation people will all come in. And then a recent trial by Raj Yoga, my friend Dr. Gupta has done it recently. And all the 3 trials, different methods. We use praksha meditation, they use Raj Yoga, and lifestyle should Shivananda Yoga. So all of them results are similar. I'll show you very briefly. This was the Ornish trial. It was only in 48 patients. We gave them a low-fat diet, stress management by yoga, etc., and psychosocial support. And what he found was that there was improvement in the cholesterol, blood pressure, and the stress, but the blockages decreased from 41 to 38%. So this was a blockages which were really not very significant. More than 70 we consider significant, but it did show that there is a regression. And in the control, it increased from 40 to 50%. So, and the need for bypass, etc., was reduced. And therefore, the cost was reduced from $243,000 from $500,000 to $200,000. In India, of course, yoga is completely free, so it will be zero, really. So, because of the limitations of this study, we did this study. This was by using, we called it, this has been published also. And again, I have the reprint, those of you who want to do it scientifically. But they accepted, it's quoted all over the world now. That praksha meditation, this is for the first time, we took patients who were having more than 70% blockage. This was a user-friendly program. We made a vegetarian diet which was acceptable to the Indian patient, not like in the hotels which they had given it. And this is for the first time that people who really need angioplasty or bypass were taken. They were not willing for, and that's why we took them, and they were studied, and we gave them a practical reversal. So, and we took again patients 42 patients who had chronic cerebral angina, and each one of them had more than 71%, at least one or two arteries. Actually, most of these people had two or three arteries blocked, and they were being advised either angioplasty or bypass, but they refused to do that. And this was our program. We asked them to control the risk factors. They were smoking. We told them not to. That is, both the groups were told. And if they were obese, if they were having other risk factors like diabetes, they were asked to control that. Then we gave them a reversal diet, because I believe yoga means a diet which is also a sattvic diet. We modified it slightly, and I will show you, because that is important to reduce the blockages. We asked them to do exercise, both the groups were asked. And these are the Preksha meditation techniques we used. Health rejuvenating exercises. These are simple exercises for all, starting from the neck to downwards. You see, for cervical spine, for the shoulders, and for the back, and so on. I'll show you some of them. These are the exercises which anybody can do. My patients who were, many of them were up till 70 years and plus, they couldn't sit, but all of them could stand. So standing, you can do all these exercises, what we call Swasthya Kriya or Health Rejuvenating. Then everybody could do this Kriyasana, relax. It's like Shavasana, a better form of Shavasana. And this also everybody can do, lying down, you can do it, sitting, you can do it. Breathing exercises everybody could do, pranayama. We just told them only two or three methods. That is Anulom Vilom, alternate nose breathing, and Nadi Shodhan, from the same nostril you do it. And a little bit of Kapalbhati also, very in a minor way. And then few asanas, those who could do it, either sitting, lying down, or standing. And then most important was meditation. And this we did, these patients were taken to the Adhyatmik Sadhana Kendra, and there they stayed for 6 days, as it's happening even today. Those of you who come to Delhi, I would invite them to join this place. Now the place has become much better. So this was our reversal. We gave them very low fat. This means only two or three spoons of oil, and we used the mustard oil. Those who did not like the taste, we said soya. Soya also has some amount of oil. We don't have the canola oil available at that time, or the rapeseed oil which is there, but mustard and rapeseed are similar. And we asked them to take a lot of fruits and vegetables. Very little cholesterol was given, even milk was given, very small amount. Actually, we have a plant in Adhyatmik Sadhana Kendra. That's the only center, I think, in the world where cow's milk has been banned now. It's only soya milk which is being given, because soya milk is supposed to be better than cow's milk. It doesn't cause lactose intolerance. It reduces cholesterol.
Goat's milk?
Pardon?
Goat's milk.
Goat's, I have no idea. Goat's, I have no data available. But between soya milk and many people here also take soya milk. You see, they are health conscious. Because, you know, lactose intolerance, cow's milk is not meant for us, if you ask me. Small amount you can take, I'm not that much against it. But it's a fact that no other a species of animal takes milk of another species. They're still healthy. Elephants, everybody is healthy. Only thing is, man is the only animal. And it causes lots of problems. See, lactose intolerance, 5% of children cannot tolerate milk at all. They are lactose intolerant. And similarly, we have partial lactose intolerance. 90% of Indians, which studies have been done here in UK, we have partial lactose intolerance. When I stopped their cow's milk, their gas stopped. We thought gas is very common in Indians. It was related to this milk, because we are partial lactose intolerant. So I think if you want to use the other milk, you use skim milk, but soya milk is much better if you can, because soya decreases cholesterol. This is one of the few food articles which has been accepted by American and British Heart Association, that 25 grams of soya can reduce your cholesterol. So this has been shown. So we do that. We ask them to take very little oil. We give them high fiber diet. High fiber diet consists of Bengal gram. Chana has been shown to reduce cholesterol. Soya has been shown. Oat bran has been. Xylem is isabgol. Fruits and vegetables. We give them lots of these fruits and vegetables. We give them lots of nuts also, which are found in vitamin E is found in these nuts, almonds, and walnuts, and so on. And flavonoids means we ask them to take colored fruits and vegetables. They have colored fruits and vegetables are better antioxidants and so on. And similarly, low salt and sugar. So our dietitians made this thing, and this was acceptable to most of the people. 90% were able to follow what we told him. So this was a vegetarian diet, consists of low fat, yes.
Is there a limitation on how much soya milk you can take?
No limitation at all.
If I take one cup or later on another cup?
Yes, yes, you can take one cup three times, four times a day. No limitation at all. There was no limitation of anything. You see, you can take, for example, salad and fruits four times a day, five times a day. Actually, they don't increase weight. And I always give a talk of eat more and weigh less. You should eat more if you want to weigh less. But you should take food which has low calories. For example, salad has almost no calories. And similarly, fruits have very little calories. So if you take fruit, vegetable diet, it is the oil which has maximum calories. 1 gram of oil gives you 9 calories. So oil should be completely stopped.
Also, and there is now almond oil.
Almond meat.
Just like soya.
Yeah, yeah. Any oil will increase your fat. You see, all these nuts have oil. 40% is oil. Whether you take almond, whether you take walnut. But that oil is good oil. That is a monounsaturated oil. Monounsaturated reduces cholesterol. There are several studies to show almonds reduce cholesterol.
Almond milk.
Pardon?
Almond milk, not oil.
Almond milk.
Just like milk, soya.
Yes. Almond so milk. Anything which has almond is good. Similarly, soya, so many things are available. So all things which have soya or almonds will be useful.
Yeah.
So there are soya based, you know, there are hundreds of articles available of soya. In India, we say you put it in the chapati, soya flour, you put this gram flour in that. That was our routine thing at all. So you can, anything
you
which has...
You get soya flour in India.
Yeah, you get soya. You get it here also.
Yeah, here we get.
Yes, there you get it very easily. All chakis put it there. So we were, our thousands of patients are taking that. And chana means with the skin on, not besan. Besan, you see, good things are removed, unfortunately, by many of these people.
Doctor.
Okay.
Doctor.
Yes.
Even at the Advaitic Sandhya Kendra.
Yeah.
They make
You have been there, so he can tell you.
Yes, and no, they make sabjis as well. Soya. Vegetable curry.
Oh, yes, yes. You see, the soya, I will not go into details. I was an advisor to the soya in association. There are 300 recipes possible. There's a book written, The Indian Recipes from Soya. There are 300. You can take in breakfast, lunch, and dinner. No. There's Nutrella, Nutri Nuggets, etc. You can use them everywhere. In the rice, you can put in the vegetables and so on. Similarly, you can take in breakfast. Tofu is tofu, all of you know that. This is a soya paneer, etc. Soya milk. Once he of course, have the smell go on, he used to put some elachi or something like that. But he has tasted it there. And people really like it, you know, the soya. Some people don't like soya milk. So you put some elachi, etc., which will see that the smell goes. But soya curd was very poor. You did take, Mr. Ashok Bhai, did you take that?
Soya curd
and yeah. Soya lassi.
Curd.
Yeah, curd and lassi. He used to make it. Yes, all the patients liked it. And we asked them, does it smell? He says, no. Because I think he had done it.
Doctor, one important thing is GM-based soya sauce. Are they any good? Different?
Pardon?
GM-based.
Oh, GM-based is bad. I'm very much against GM.
Yeah, so you don't advise
it. Fortunately, it's not allowed here also for the time.
No.
It's not allowed in India.
It could be GM-based as well in this country.
GM-based is very little. Do you have? No, I don't.
I'm asking you.
No. GM-based is terrible. I will talk about that.
GM-based?
This genetically modified is most dangerous. I'll talk about that later. I'm very much against it. And I have been fighting with the Indian government. They are already having some. They have this GM cotton. They are having going like GM brinjal or something like that. So that will be very dangerous. I'll come to that in a minute. But yes, I am only for organic vegetables. Not even every type of vegetable we get in India is terrible. They put a lot of sprays and insecticides and so on. Everything is really polluted. But I agree with you. I'm very much against this GM. And I'll talk about that because that's my... Okay, these are some of the asanas. As I said, I will not go into details and all, but 50% of the people could not do asanas. We did not bother. Everybody could do this HRE, health rejuvenating exercises. So these are some asanas standing, some are on sitting and some are lying on the back, some lying prone. So these were some of the asanas. Those who could do it, we asked them. But everybody could do this. This is Adhyatmik Sadhana Kendra. Those of you, this has changed now. Have you seen that? It has changed now. This is this is the original photograph in 2000. And you see Swami Dharmanandi, he's teaching now. Everybody can do this. This is called Shavasana or Kayotsa. This is very simple. This is a method of relaxing by auto-suggestion. You just lie down with the closed eyes and then concentrate on your toes, that the toes I have got tired, now I'm relaxing them. You move them and relax them. And then the lower part of the leg, upper part of the leg, then the right leg like that, then the abdomen, you tell abdomen, all the organs like kidneys, liver, you are working 24 hours, I'm relaxing you. Just auto suggestion. We don't know what's happening, but then the heart and the chest and the back and the whole body, the neck and the mind. So this is a method of relaxing by auto suggestion. And you'll be surprised. I had patients who had heart disease. They would not be able to sleep at home, but during Kayosar, about 30% will sleep. They start snoring and work. Of course, you can't sleep on the soft beds that you have. If you want to really sleep, I tell them that take this mat and sleep on the floor. Even in England, I tell them, and do some Kayosar, because Kayosar cannot be done on the beds. If you're a hard bed, yes, it can be done. And many people who are not able to sleep, they are able to sleep by this. This is also called Yog Nidra, in other words. So Yog Nidra is a method, a yogic method of getting sleep and all. Those who become expert can do it. So this is a very simple method. You start sort of suggesting your body that you are getting tired, you were tired, you are working whole day for me, now I am relaxing you, your mind is relaxing. So what has happened during this activity, a lot of scientific studies have been done. Your basal metabolic rate comes down, heart rate comes down, blood pressure comes down. During this activity, Dr. Date had shown long back that doing by Shavasana, your blood pressure can come down by 20%, 30%, especially if you are having high blood pressure. So a very useful technique, and this has been shown even to cause relaxation of the mind by alpha waves and so on. So a very simple technique, you can do it really. So everybody can do this. All my patients were able to do it. Asanas, I said, were difficult. And this is Adhyatmik Sadhana. It has improved markedly. Now we have an automatic meditation room here with all the colored and all that thing. I haven't brought the picture, but it has really markedly improved. You should see that if you are come today. And anybody can do this. This is a close-up of that. It's a method, again, concentrating on each portion of the body and relaxing it, and it's extremely useful. And this is pranayama. Again, it's not necessary that you sit on the floor. Some of these people are saying this is alternate nose breathing and then Nadi Shona from the same side. But idea is again that we teach them how to breathe properly, abdominal breathing, and then tell them to take deep breaths and to slow it down. Because normally we don't use full lungs, you see, we use only 60%. 40% of the lungs are not used. Here we are trying to optimize the capacity of your lungs. And this is, if you can't sit on the floor, you can sit on the chair, like you see this lady, and you can do this sitting on the chair. So, Kayosar can be done, Pranayama could be done. This was done by everybody. And these are health rejuvenating exercises. These are pretty simple, as I said, these are stretching exercises, and they start from the neck, then they go to the shoulder, then they go to the chest, like you see it here. We do it with breathing, for example, we ask the people to stop breathing, and then take a deep breath out, like this. We initially tell them to take it out with the sound C, like this, and then with the breath, this is one, and that is two, and like this. Very simple. These are for the chest, these are you are being seen here, and then they are for the back, they are for the knees, etc. These are extremely good to keep the body flexible, and everybody could do that. And Dharmanandji has written several books. I don't know whether the book is here. You have that?
We have got a collection of books.
So there's a collection of this.
We'll put it on this.
Health rejuvenating. I have a CD also. If you want, I can give it to him. You can all have the pen drive on that.
I don't see any ladies there. So what do they do? They have men separate, ladies separate?
Yeah, actually ladies, well, you'll see that in a minute. Unfortunately, this study was done only in men. But I tell you, and we have been subsequently having such camps right there. This is in Gangaram Hospital also. We have been doing small camps there. You can see the number of people. You see the ladies here.
Yes.
Simple exercises which everybody can do. These are people who have never done yoga, etc. And most of them are able to do that. So, and these are some of the other bhujangasana, etc. Simple asana, many people could do it. So this is, we have been subsequently carrying on in many other places. This may be difficult for some, but others can do it. Trikonasana. And this is meditation. This was the most important part. Again, Swami Dharmananda, you can see there. teaching them. And this again is very easy to learn. There are so many types of meditation, you see. And this is one of the simplest type which can be learned. And meditation is the real thing in yoga, because meditation has been shown to change the body biochemistry completely. All the bad hormones are reduced, the good hormones are increased, our nervous system changes from sympathetic to parasympathetic system, and the mind becomes completely relaxed. A huge number of studies are available on the biochemistry of meditation, and it is a fact that this is the best thing. And this is the best thing to remove your stress also, because meditation tells you, who am I? I am not the body, because body is dying all the time. You see, we were children at one time, child has died, youth has died for me. Now, but I have not died, I am different than all this. Bodies are dying. And as a doctor, I can tell you, every year your body changes. 98% of the cells have to die every year. So, we are rejuvenating every year. The bones change every 3 months, the liver changes every 2 months, the red blood cells change every 4 weeks. Every part of the body dies and regenerates, so you are not able to see it. Even the DNA changes every 6 weeks or so, but it is replicated. So we are not the body, because body is dying. We are the mind is controlling that. Mind is creating thoughts, it's controlling the body. But mind is controlled by something called consciousness, or soul, or spirit, whatever you want to call it. So here the question is, we cannot show what consciousness is. We can experience it. And some people ask me, how do you experience it? So when we say, close your eyes and watch your breath. Now, who is watching the breath? Eyes are closed. It is your consciousness. You are getting in touch with, who am I? So, I am the consciousness, which has, of course, a mind and the body, but we are the consciousness, which are not going to die. The body is dying every day, and it will die ultimately, but I cannot die, I am different. So, I think that awareness, if comes, then we live in so-called spiritual consciousness, and all the problems are solved then, because nothing can happen to me, it can happen to my body. So, this is what it is. Anyhow, but meditation has been shown to, if you do it properly every day, it really improves your health. It also improves your efficiency. It makes you calm. It makes you have bad emotions out of you, like anger, ego, etc. You become compassionate. I have seen thousands of patients who have changed. Striking example was of a lady. She said, you have changed my husband, what have you done to her? He said, nothing, 6 days in the court. No, he says, this fellow used to shout at servants. The children were scared because homework is not done. Now he doesn't shout, he's a different man. A single man who changes himself can change the family. And similarly, that's why Acharya Mahaprajna used to say that if you want to change the world, change yourself. You can change only one person, and that's the best achievement in your life, that is yourself. Yourself means, how do you change? Both physically, mentally, emotionally, no anger, ego, etc., and spiritually. So change yourself, you will see that the family, in that person's case, the family changed, and similarly, the family will change the neighborhood and the whole country and the whole world. That's why many people say, if 1% of the population does meditation, there will be world peace. This is a fact many of the spiritual masters have. And meditation can be done sitting on the chair also, as you see here, this lady is doing it. And this is where the ladies were. You see, although the studies were done in male patients, but I think the success of this study was because of the ladies. We always said, bring your spouse in the program, and still it's being done. Because it is the ladies who manage the kitchen, when we told what type of diet, etc. And secondly, they were a very good social support. One person is doing yoga in the house, everybody thinks he's nuts or something like that.
Yeah.
Now if there is a support of the wife, that makes it. And secondly, the people like to cheat. We used to, because research study used to ask, how many days you do yoga? He'll say 4 or 5, but the lady will say, no, he's telling a lie. So they control the diet, they also gave them social support. And that's why we say, if there is a sickness in the family, one member is suffering, if there's a family support, that person recovers quickly. There's a lot of data on this. So this is exactly what we did in yoga also, that not only they gave support, etc., and they improved much better, because many of them did not have heart disease. I said, you will never get heart disease. The best is to get this. So, this is we were giving. This is a very old photograph. You won't see such work of 96 or 97. And you see that we were taking classes by yoga experts as well as the doctors as well as nutritionists. So a good experiment combining science and spirituality. Actually, if you want to remove the problems of this world, you have to combine science with spirituality. Pure science can be very dangerous. You saw Hitler, what did he do? He destroyed the whole world. It was science. And you have to combine science with spirituality, only then you can be like Mother Teresa and everything. So this everybody accepts. So this is whatever results what we found, that I will not go into details. This is Bhiksha meditation on the right side, you see. We call it yoga. There was a reduction in weight. Many people were overweight, some more than 100 kilos. There were three patients and they reduced by 30%, but it's statistically significant. And in the control group, there's nothing. You see, you have to do a control study to be sure scientifically it's correct. So control group was not taught meditation, they were just taught the usual thing. And you can see the angina, they used to get pain on chest when walking, improved by 73% by Bhiksha meditation, and there was worsening in the control group. And same thing, objective tests were done by treadmill test and thallium test. Again, a marked improvement in the Bhiksha meditation, a deterioration. You see, disease has a tendency to deteriorate with whatever methods we have. We all were being given drugs and they were doing the same thing, but those who were doing Bhiksha meditation, we showed it, they are doing much better. The cholesterol reduced markedly. This was done at a time when statins were not being used. Of course, in the other study, we have used statins also. But you can see as much reduction of 20% of total cholesterol, LDL, bad cholesterol reduced by 23%. So what we showed is that even cholesterol can come down. Subsequently, there have been at least 20 articles to show that cholesterol can be reduced if your mind is relaxed. So this is a very good method of reducing the cholesterol as well as blood sugar and blood pressure. And this is, everybody had angiography done twice. And you can see that there was a regression of about 20%. You can see on the left hand side, this is the group of yoga, the red one, and they had 20% reduction as compared to 2% in the control group. And progression also was worse. So we said it is possible to regress. Nobody had ever shown it, that with any meditation you can regress such advanced disease.
So what is the middle thing, no change?
No change means it is retardation of, it remained the same. It was 70%, remained 70%. Normally it has a tendency to progress, as you see that yellow thing there. So at least we called it retardation of progression of disease, which is also a great thing. This is called retardation of progression. The disease did not progress, remained where it was. And but there was a regression in 20%, there was lack of progression in the quite a number. And need for angioplasty and bypass was reduced. You can see this Bhiksha meditation group. They all been published. I'll give you a copy if you want. All this data is already authenticated. So need for angioplasty or bypass. From that time, we are regular camps, and we have saved large number of people who would have gone for angioplasty or bypass, because we have objective data. And this is for statistical analysis. You can see that everything is statistically significant on the right hand side, whether it's angina, weight reduction, cholesterol, bad cholesterol, treadmill test, and blockages in the arteries, and need for angioplasty bypass. Everything was statistically significant. You see on the p-value, those who are inclined towards the statistics and all. More important than this, you see, the stress was also markedly reduced. Already people have stress, but if anybody knows, my arteries are blocked, two or three arteries is markedly stressed, and that was reduced. And the need for medicines for diabetes and blood pressure also reduced. So this is the third study which was done, Raj Yoga, exactly similar results. This is the largest study. This is done by Raj Yoga, my friend in Mount Abu has done this thing. And they also took 300 patients. And again, they showed that there is a reduction in the blockages, exactly like we assumed. There was reduction in blood pressure. And also they studied white, the thing improves. They studied that some of the bad hormones like catecholamines, cortisol, etc. decrease. And good hormones and melatonin, this is the antioxidant, which causes sleep also. It increases. So the mechanism was also studied by them. So yoga has been shown to improve concentration. Does it have, in small children, it has been shown to improve the memory and all. Their performance, the examination improves. Several studies are there. It improves work efficiency in the people who are corporates. And as I showed you, data is available of transcendental meditation. Those offices where they do half an hour of meditation before, their efficiency goes up. Improves quality of life, in immunity it increases. It's being tried in HIV now, and of course best method of controlling stress, and many lifestyle diseases including diabetes, heart disease, and psychosomatic depression, etc., can be prevented or reversed. It has potential to reverse heart disease, and the idea of yoga or pranayama is not to keep you free from the disease, but make you lead a really happy and a healthy life. And this has all been shown. If you saw the slogan for this year's International Day of Yoga, it was harmony and peace. This is a very strong word. Harmony is a very strong word. Harmony in yourself, that means between your mind and body. Secondly, harmony between yourself and your family members, and your neighborhood and the whole country and the whole world. So this is harmony, and then you achieve peace. So this is what yoga is all about, for harmony and peace. And these are diseases which can be controlled. There are a lot of data. I'm not sure. Hypertension, heart disease, I've shown. Diabetes, a huge number of data, including metabolic syndrome, asthma, migraine, irritable bowel, and psychomotor disease. Even in cancer, there's data that yoga can decrease the cells which cause cancer. And Dean Ornish has shown that in prostate cancer, yoga is as good as the chemotherapy. This is one study available, but it may be as good as chemotherapy, one study available. He has also shown it is anti-aging. I mean, he has done by the Nobel laureate the telomere length at a very biochemical level, that you get anti-aging. And somebody was asking about dementia, possibly it could. And we are not the only one who are believing. Look at many hospitals in the Western countries, like New York is a Columbia Presbyterian Medical Center, where an American is a cardiac surgeon. He calls patients 2 days before bypass surgery. They do meditation, and then the recovery is much quicker, and they have less complications. This has all been published again, and that's why many magazines also have come out that how mind can heal your body. There's nothing but yoga. Mind-body medicine is yoga only, and a lot of data is an old issue, but several new issues are. There's so many other physiological factors which are there. It has breath, physical fitness, your oxygen capacity increases, anxiety, and there's an increase in the alpha waves, means you relax. There are endorphins, natural antioxidants, which are increased, and these damages to the arteries become less, and so on. I'll not go into detail, but mechanisms are also available with this yoga. In rehabilitation also, that's why I'm here. We are doing a very large study now with London School of Tropical Health and Imperial College, 16 hospitals in India and 4 in the UK. We are doing this study now for last 1 year, and we are trying to show that cardiac rehabilitation is possible with yoga, and it will be as effective as costly rehab. Rehabilitation is very important. You see, any patient who gets heart attack or a bypass, he must get rehabilitation, because rehabilitation can decrease the death rate by 30% in the next year or so. But it's not being yet done. Even in UK, the data that we got is 40% don't do rehab, because it's very costly, and it involves lots of experts, like an exercise physiologist, like a nutritionist, a psychologist. But we have shown that yoga may be as good as combining all those things. So it's being tested now, and we will have the results in the next 3 or 4 years. If this is so, I think this will be the biggest achievement of yoga, because such a large study has never been done. 1 year it took us to find out the protocol, and it was all done in Preksha Meditation Center, Adhyatmik Sadhana Kendra, and Swami Dharmananji and others suggested lots of things. So mostly it is Preksha Meditation, things that I have shown you also, which are being incorporated in this largest ever Indo-UK study, you know, and the small studies to show it is good. So yoga is nothing, it's not a few asanas, I must tell you. It's a complete way of, it's the best lifestyle. And many studies have shown that it's good in hypertension, obesity, diabetes, and mental stress. It can even regress the early and advanced blockages. It's useful for rehabilitation. And it increases compliance. As I said, people who do yoga, their exercise and diet also becomes, has no side effects. Of course, more studies are needed, as we are doing it now. And that's why many hospitals have taken up, like the hospital, like in All India Institute, I was there, that had taken up. But even in Gangaram Hospital, we have a small room, it's called a yoga lifestyle clinic. And where we have a instructor again, who is teaching Preksha Meditation He's from Madhavnisar. And he uses in all these conditions. If a strong family history is there, hypertension, diabetes, obesity, rehabilitation. All patients after angioplasty and bypass are getting this yoga also in addition to all the medicines. It's being used for stress management, anxiety, depression, meditation, and learn happy, stress-free. And especially the doctors and nurses are under so much of stress. So we are having special sessions for them. And of course we are doing research and all. Thank you. I think I would like to stop it here. If there are any questions, I'll be very happy to answer.
There's one question with reference to... One question with reference to what we heard today.
Yes.
And any research done from your experience with reference to swimming and what we heard today.
In reference to?
What we heard today and swimming. You know, in swimming we have breathing techniques.
Yes.
Right. Is there any research done from your knowledge?
On the breathing techniques?
Yeah, with while you are swimming. Yeah.
While you are?
Swimming.
No. See,
there's nothing there. Okay.
No. During exercise and swimming, you know, the breathing becomes fast. It is like Kapalbhati. It's become fast itself. So there, the effects of both exercise as well as so-called Kapalbhati, rapid breathing, you're using most of the lungs. It's the whole idea of yoga is that we have potential lot of energy, we are not using it. So we are in exercise while we are using, we are also using quite a bit of the energy. So there breathing becomes quicker, like we do in Kapalbhati. We use most of the lungs there. And secondly, the benefits of swimming itself are there. But during swimming, nobody has studied. You don't want to slow down the breathing while you are swimming.
It's different, isn't it? It's very personal breathing when you're swimming, very personal.
Yeah, it becomes fast, there's no question.
Yeah.
When you are running, the breathing has to become fast. And similarly, in breathing exercises, we tell you something called Kapalbhati. So that is, you have to breathe fast with your stomach and all that. And that also has an effect, because it removes all your bad things quickly and so on. Yes. I thought you were asking singing. A lot of data is there on singing and smiling and clapping and all, because yoga sessions ends with laughter and also clapping and all. We have some groups. There's a lady here also in London. They are expert in laughter yoga. 1 hour of session we have also in our club once a month, which is a laughter yoga. This is full 1 hour of laughter with yoga. You do all the exercises and go on laughter and so on. Right? So laughter is the best medicine, because as I said, you have to be like a child. And a child smiles 200 times a day, we don't. A lot of benefits are there. You should read a book by Normal Cousins, It's Anatomy of Sickness. This was written long back, 20 years back, 30 years back. He had ankylosing spondylosis. Doctors in America said nothing can be done. So somebody said, why don't you start smiling or laughing. He saw those Charlie Chaplin films. It's a beautiful book also, he's written. And he improved. His disease completely disappeared, which is unknown. You see, ankylosing spondylosis disappearing is not, but it's a book he's written. It's called Anatomy of Sickness by Normal Cousins. Norman, N-O-R-M-A-N-C-O. Anatomy of Sickness. It's a very, very old book.
It's not Noel Cousins, is it? Noel Cousins.
Not Noel, Norman. N-O-R-M-A-N. Cousins. A very old book, I think it was written before many of you were born, but it's a beautiful book still, one of the best books.
Doctor, most of the disease you mentioned, they are genetic, aren't they?
They are not.
No. Cholesterol, diabetes?
No.
Unfortunately, they are not. You see, what has happened, you saw in 50 years, the disease has increased 5 times. Mm-hmm. You think our genes have changed in 5 years? Mm-hmm. In next 20 years, the disease is going to double, 100% increase. Our genes do not change that quickly. Yes, we are genetically predisposed, that I agree. But the genes are getting expressed now because of lifestyle. There's Dr. Kunar here, my friend in UK, who has done huge work. He says genes are not different. It is the epigenetics, it's the gene expression which is changed. You see, you have the same genes, but if you are not doing exercise, if you are smoking, the gene will express something. So if you are under stress, the gene will express. On the other hand, yoga can suppress the gene expression that Dean Ornish has shown very clearly. So it is a gene expression which is coming, and this is related to our lifestyle. Yes, Indians are genetically predisposed. It is said that. Why do we get heart disease? Because at one time these things were good for us. Metabolic syndrome was good. This central obesity, high triglycerides were good because we used to die of starvation. In India, I know people used to die because there used to be famines and all. So our body over millions of years changed. We developed so-called central obesity. We developed high triglycerides, insulin resistance. Good if you are starving. But suddenly people are overeating now. People are dying more of overeating or eating normal food than our ancestors used to die because of starvation. So that was good. But the genes do not change that quickly. So that took millions of years. So I agree with you. Many people say genetically we are predisposed, but it's not true. If genetics are responsible in 20 years, why disease is going to double? Heart, diabetes is going to increase 300%. So you think genes are going to change in 10 years? They're not. So these are not genetic. I think that we should remove. In cholesterol, 95% is related to our diet, 5% genetics. They are very high cholesterol. They have 1,000, 2,000 cholesterol, but that is a very rare. Yes.
We had a question there first.
Yes.
Right, people on medication, should they stop the medication
if
they're doing this? Reduce it over a period of time?
Yes. You see, if you start a disease when the disease is starting, then you can stop. For example, mild hypertension. Your blood pressure is 160 by 100. You don't need any drugs. You try it for 3 months or so. Simple diabetes, your HbA1c says 7.5 or something like that. Blood sugar is just slightly high. Then no medicine. But if you've got a heart attack, like all my patients had heart disease, the blockages are there. I have done angio. So all of these patients were taking medicines. So medicines with this, and if you have very high blood pressure, very high sugar, I have seen many people, the insulin comes down right in the ashram itself. They are on insulin, but it comes down. No, I don't want you to stop the medicine at all. As a cardiologist, once you got a heart attack, you have to take lifelong statins, you have to take lifelong aspirin. There's no question.
No, but there's controversy on statins. Some say it's not good for you. Others say they gave you by default. Doctors prescribe.
For secondary prevention, there's no doubt about it. The biggest advance in the medical science which has occurred is statins. Statins have saved millions of lives. So, there's no question, but the only question is, they are controversial. If you don't have heart disease, should you take statin? No. Aspirin should you take, then you have no heart disease. Diabetes also, the role is controversial. People who are having no risk factors, you don't give them unnecessarily. Every medicine has a side effect. But if you have high risk diabetes, then you must take it. Because as I said, diabetes is a heart disease. 70-80% people die because of heart disease, not because of diabetes, not because of sugar. So, there is a little controversy in those mild group, but otherwise, yes.
Yeah, we have one question. Yeah, now when you take out life insurance, they ask if any of your parents who have got cancer or anything.
Yes.
But you're saying that it's not genetic.
It's not
family.
No, but if you write your father or parents had cancer, will they not give you the policy?
But they will.
It's not. It's
the
family
history is there.
No. How much higher? I don't know. Because these are not proven things, you see.
Yeah.
These are absolutely not proven. So it is the environment which is a dominant factor. There's no question about it. Heart disease, yes. A lot of genes are being studied in hypertension, diabetes. I know all that. We are also involved in a lot of this. But the question is, it's not the genes. It's the gene expression. You see, the insurance company in the United States have recognized Dean Ornish program of reversal of heart disease. Unfortunately, it is not recognized other places. You could also ask your insurance company that they should recognize this program. At least Dean Ornish, which is a US program, our program, they may not recognize. It's a similar program. So it's much more advanced. Because it has been shown that people who do this, they get less sort of, they get less premium. Because they live longer.
Thank you.
You said Indians are more prone to heart disease. Has there been any study done about, like, the arteries, are they narrower in Indians because they were living in a hot climate, so you didn't need thicker arteries? Because if you see, like, the Western diet, people who are smoking and drinking and eating lots of red meat sometimes don't get heart attacks compared to a lot of Indians who are not doing any of these things. So I just wondered if anybody's checked whether the arteries.
Oh yes, we have checked that. There's a lot of data on that. You see, initially the surgeons told us that the arteries in Indians are small because when they are operating, they say small arteries and all. We did a study in All India Institute. I was a part of that study. We studied, the arteries are small, but it is according to the body weight. So Indians have the body mass index in Indians is 1.6 or something, as against 1.9 here. So if you correct it for the body mass, they are not small. So that myth was removed. Why they look small to the surgeons is because by the time Indians go to the surgeon, the disease is diffuse. It is arteries that look very small inside, but they are not. So Indians don't have small arteries. I think that should be removed. Whether you are staying in a hot climate, there should be more. Actually, they are vasodilatation, as we call it. In a hot climate, theoretically, if you ask me as a doctor, the arteries should be bigger. They cannot be smaller because they dilate, you see. If you go to a hot sun, you are flushed. Why are you flushed? Because your capillaries and your arteries, etc., are flushed and all. So it should be large, but they are not small anymore. That we have clarified long back. According, if you correct for the body weight or body mass index, they are the same. Yes. What else did you say?
I just wondered because why Indians are getting so many? So
being an Indian is why Indians are getting that's a million-dollar question. A lot of research is being done by my colleagues in UK itself. Dr. Konar is Hammersmith Hospital. He's the professor. He's done a lot of work. And what they find is that Indians have something called this is genetically metabolic syndrome, which we acquired. Metabolic syndrome means we are supposed to live in starvation. We should eat. Our ancestor used to tell us, eat 25% less than your appetite is. So we are tuned by our genes to live in a diet which should be deficient in calories. Because only thing which prolongs life, you know, is what? In whole world, everything they have tried. If you want to live longer, eat less. 25% less calories. This has been shown. Nobody disagrees with that. For longevity, this. So we are used to taking less food. But the moment we start taking more food and more calories and so on and so forth, we will get this disease because our body is tuned to get this thing. And secondly, we have changed our lifestyle very quickly. You know, Europeans and Americans took 200, 300 years, slowly the things. Now, a McDonald's, there are more centers in India as compared to the United States. I think London has more McDonald's than any other place, even in US. You know. So, I think these globalization has really harmed this quite a bit. So, I think it is a rapidity of change of lifestyle. But yes, we are supposed to stay in a diet which is supposed to be less in calories, in starving diet. That's what our body is all about. So that way you are correct, that we should really be eating on a very frugal diet, a diet which is low in calories and so on. But we have started eating too much.
One last question, Doctor.
Yes.
Are Indians not genetically very diverse people?
Yes.
We are we not? People of India.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so we can apply the same basis on all Indian people.
That's true. But you see, there has to be a common gene. I travel all over India. See, our diet is completely different. You go to south, they take rice, etc. North, in Kashmir, they take rice, etc. You go to east, they take fish and mustard oil in the northern part, they start taking. Everywhere it's increasing. Why it is increasing, nobody is clear about it. Everybody says, my colleagues say, that they are taking much more fat diet, they are not doing exercise and stress. But there is one factor which is common. It is not proven as yet, and I have challenged many people to do it. You see, one thing is common in Indians. Everything is different. I agree with you. We are like a continent. One thing is common. We are all spiritual people. You agree? Go down south, there is a Lord Krishna, there is a God down, up north, everywhere. So we are all spiritual people. It is lack of spirituality which is causing us the disease. This is what is happening. We were very, very spiritual people. We were really spiritually inclined. And suddenly we have become, completely different. Spirituality has gone. So that is why this may be a reason. And that's why spirituality is coming into this. That's the only common thing that I know of. Nothing is common. Diet is common? No. Similarly, our cover, our genes are different. And all. But there are some commonality in the genes also, the Indians, etc., which have been studied here. Dr. Konar has done a lot of work. He has studied the Indians, he has studied the other immigrants and all that. He found that exactly the similar genes are there. Indians have not different genes. It's a gene expression which is changing because of the lifestyle. It's called epigenetics. You may have a gene to get our forefathers had the same gene to get diabetes, but they never got it because they were doing exercise, they were stress-free, they were taking a good diet. They were not smoking. So that's all. That's all we are trying to tell you. Whatever your genes are, please. Yes.
You mentioned, Doctor, about the children. They also good results in their exam time, or
of course,
a nice style. Can you please tell at what age, like babies, toddlers, that this could be applied?
You see, Swami Dharmanandi has done a study just now in schools, which are say class 4 to 8. What he has taken children who cause problems there, you know. He says those children who trouble you, please, I will teach them meditation. They have improved and all that. But there is a study done, very small children, we have no data, but there is a study done in a medical college in Mumbai. This is a professor, my colleague. What she did was first year MBBS student, they must be 16, 18 years or more. Half the students were taught meditation, half were not. Those who were taught, they topped in the exam. So whole college is doing it now. Even in the schools, you see, all the bad habits decrease. The performance does improve. You see, many parents have said this. There's no systematic study done. But there are several methods which are based on, you must have heard of De Silva's method,
yeah,
of improving the memory. They're based on yoga only, if you go
mind
there.
Control.
There are several methods. And they have documented that the memory of the children improves and they perform better. But objective study that I am quoting is published. This is in medical college, first year. And these are 18 year old, but I'm sure it's true for the younger children also. So
is there any restriction in the age that they could start?
No restriction at all. The children, you see, we cause them stress. If we can remove stress, that's the best thing. The child is not born with a stress. We create stress. We tell them to do all wrong things. I'll tell you a simple example. My friend, Dr. Shiv Khera talks about it. He says a child picks up at the age of 3 years, phone for the first time in his life. He's very excited. He gets the first phone. It's he says, I want to talk to your father. He runs to his father. His father says, please tell him I'm not there. Now the child is never, he doesn't know what is a lie. He says, but father, you are there. This is the first phone in his life. He says, no, you go and tell him, otherwise I'll slap you. The child is confused. He says, my father is there. He says, he's not there. He's confused. He picks up the phone. And he picks up the phone and he says, my father says he's not there. Then we reward him for their wrong things, you see. Then he's trained. After that, he's being rewarded by a chocolate or something. Then he picks up the phone after a few months. The father says, what did you say? He runs inside. He says, I said, I will check up whether father is there. He says, yes, you get a reward now. So, I think we are telling wrong things to our children. We should be role models for them. We don't talk the truth, we tell them to talk truth. We don't take good food, we tell them. We don't do meditation, we ask them not to be under stress. We are under stress. So, I think we should be good role models, and that is what it is. Our generation has failed as role models, I can tell you that. In at least in India, I talked to many young children. He says, one of the very family, this child is not obeying us. And I talked to the child, he says, problem is not with me, it's with my parents.
Yeah.
They have no time for me. They're going to kitty parties, this thing, that thing, and they are doing all sorts of wrong things. And they are telling me, I have nothing wrong. Wrong is with them. So I think we have to be good. What if we want our children to improve? We can't really expect them to be just, they see everything. And we are teaching them to be under stress. We in India, everybody wants your child should have 99%. If you're 98, stress. We don't want them to be good human beings. We want them to be good computers.
Mm-hmm.
So that's not right. So this Vivekananda said, what is the idea of education? To create good human beings, no? Good people who can mug up things and all, like computers. So I think we have forgotten all that. And this is the Indian system which is coming now. This is the moral system and so on and so forth. Many schools are adopting it in India. And they are in US, and I'm sure some schools here also are adopting it. Yes.
Professor. So first of all, when you're doing your research, is there a prerequisite of people believing in consciousness or spirituality? Not everyone in your research people believe in soul or spirituality or consciousness. So how does your research work if people just don't believe in this?
No, we don't have to make them believe. We tell them that there is a possibility. You see, a person who has 3 arteries blocked, he doesn't want to get operated. I say, all right, you lifestyle and all, but if you add yoga, he may not understand what yoga is. We don't want him to even understand. Some people may not understand. But if you add yoga with this, it's possible you may be able to avoid. That's all.
Mm-hmm.
And these are, of course, people who are motivated highly because they have disease, they want to do anything.
Mm-hmm.
And we said there's a scientific method. There's so many gimmicks going on to avoid heart attacks and so on. But this is one of the scientific methods. So many people join us. But the problem is, people who don't have disease to make them join. That is the most important part. because the maximum benefit is so-called primordial prevention. When you have no disease, at that time, that's the best time. So children will be the best, because disease develops from the age of 10 years, I told you. Disease doesn't develop overnight. It takes 40 years for a heart attack to develop. Yes.
Yes, I would like to support your stand on spirituality completely, because I have a little bit studied Gita and other things. I benefited from it. Also, in the last 40 or even 50 years of time, I have been a cardiac patient or whatever you call it. I've gone through many, many very, very serious events,
yes.
Extremely critical.
Yes.
When I'm on that side of the line or on this side of the line, that critical, almost seven of them, and many more of a middle level, where I'm on within the line, but any time I can cross the line during the 40 years' time. But what had happened was in 1974, for some of my problem, my mother gave me Aleshwar Bhagwan's photo,
yeah.
which is on the Palitana, the top there, sir.
Yeah.
Everybody is trained here, so they would know it. And I've been keeping that photo under my pillow. And whenever I had an incident, whenever I went to the hospital under critical condition, you go into your ward, you put your robe on, and then I sit down, I put Aleshwar Bhagwan's photo in front of me, I submit to him completely, complete surrender. And then I'm not the body, he's looking after me, I'm completely free from everything. And I do really become completely free, I'm totally myself, just like you say, that I feel myself, that I am the soul, nothing will ever happen to me, I'm eternal, and I'm completely free from any problem. Death doesn't bother me at all. And whatever happens, yeah, my friend Dinesh Bhai, he tells me, Praveen Bhai, you've got a little willpower. I said, not one iota of will exists there. You have submitted everything away, and then you pray, and then you are completely stress-free. During that time, when my family members come to visit me, my wife, my son, my baby, they're all looking very stressed, very, very serious looking, and I'm smiling at them. And yet, inside me, I've got a pain,
yeah.
I know. Sometimes it's stable, sometimes it very goes up, aggravated, then I'm a little bit serious. But other times I'm completely free. After the operation, I'm still in the mode. It lasts for about 4 or 5 days. Again, I'm back to normal. I come out, the doors are closed behind. I can't go back again. But during that period of time, and this must have happened almost every time, once it didn't happen in 2007, in my angiogram, after the angiogram, they were able to do angioplasty, but I started having a pain and it was stopped. And for some reason, I could not do my prayer and I was really stressed. I was really worried, extremely anxious and everything. There was one instance in all this period of time. But just to tell everybody, spirituality is one of the greatest things. It cures you.
Oh, sure.
About 2 years ago, 2 years and 2 months ago, I had a cardiac arrest. Within second, I was out, and I remained unconscious for 16 to 18 minutes. Heart would stop, that is, unconscious. And my son gave me the breathing,
CPR.
According to the instruction given to him. Ambulance came, they gave me the artificial breathing. I was for 5 days, I was told that no guarantee that I'll come back. I think I was in spiritual state, although I had not time to pray.
Good.
And I came out,
yeah,
and I told my wife a few words, which she said it was something like that. And I'm now back to normal, I'm doing breathing, everything.
Good.
And alone below, and it brought me back to life. Otherwise, I was a skeleton almost after this recovery. And I have recovered, and I'm doing this yoga, has recovered me also. One question I want to ask you is that at the moment I'm going through one technical problem, that in the morning when I go to evacuate, to go to toilet, and after 1 or 2 minutes, my BP goes up very high. It goes to 200 plus, 200, sometimes 180, but other times 200, 210, and a little bit more also. And the bottom one goes to 100, 110, once it was 128. I didn't feel the stress because I was still in the normal under that condition, even at 100. One would be very stressed, completely attention and everything. The tension was not there, but I knew the condition was extremely critical. I took the spray, settled down. But what happens is that when I take spray, or before going to toilet, I take the spray, and then it settles down. but the pressure is very high. Say it is 190 over 100.
Sure.
And then after spray and other thing that I go nurofen, 15 minutes, 20 minutes, the pressure starts coming down, 150, 130, and then it becomes 130 over 70. And this is such a wide range of violation which I never had before. What is the reason for this?
Thank you. I think for supporting our cause of spirituality, you are, I think, one of the best examples, although I have not done research so much cases, but I have 80,000 patients who have been able to avoid bypass. Once you pray, what are you doing actually? The thing is, you suddenly become spiritual because humility comes. You feel there is somebody bigger than you. And the second thing which comes is positive thinking.
Correct.
That God is going to cure me. You see, it is the positive thinking and humility which is meditation. So this means you are doing meditation all the time. And meditation has tremendous powers. Actually, meditation changes our mind. Mind is the biggest pharmacy in this world. Every medicine can be built inside our mind. We have painkillers right inside. Some people feel very little pain, they are hurt, others. So there are so many things happening in the mind, so everything is possible. But I think you are one of the extreme examples. I am glad that you have done so well and all that. Like you are saying, your blood pressure goes up and all, maybe you are having some angina or something like that, you should take a tablet or a spray of nitric acid before you. And secondly, don't remain constipated, because sometimes the pressure itself can increase the... So you should take some laxative, like...
I'm taking that one. There's no problem. But after that, after 1, 2, or 3 minutes, I think what happens is my organs here would have been stressed.
So that's why.
Then there's not enough blood flow
you
there.
You should take a spray of nitroglycerin as you are taking. That will be the best. Right?
But anyway, the thing is, there's no demand at any time that please save me or take me out of this. No. It's completely what you decide is acceptable to me.
You have done the best thing. You see, you have given a lecture just like this. I wish people are like that. But I think a little small prayer now, a lot of data is there, 40 studies on prayer, not only for yourself, other people can also recover if you pray, depending on any religion at all. Recently, one article has come, an American journal, that a patient, religion not known, different people were asking, Hindu, Muslim, Christians, that you go and pray for this man. And that man recovered. They say irrespective, there is no religion involved at all. You pray in your own method, in your own religious method. But the man recovered. There is no religion, nobody knows. So I think prayer has very strong, but the data is coming only now. And it is not easy to get such data because you have to convince people to believe in this first. I'm glad. Thank you very much.
So is it at that time that the other person who's being prayed for is aware that he's being prayed for by someone?
He's not aware, he's unconscious. He's in the ICU sometimes.
But it still helps.
Yes, yes, it helps.
It's not,
this is called collective consciousness. You see, after all, there is something called universal consciousness. We all have bodies, we have consciousness, and we have external energy outside called vibrations. And this can be photographed by some cameras, like you might have heard of Kirlian photography. You know? So we are all, we are actually vibrations. If you read Deepak Chopra's, a good friend of mine, book, we are all vibrations. We don't look vibration, but we are having some vibrations around us. So many centers you go to, Brahmakumaris I go, we are going to Mount Abu after. So there are some vibrations come. So certain people are positive, and doctors also. The person wants to go to a doctor, he is healed by the same medicine, the other doctor is not healed. So there is a personal aura. And there is something, if we combine all of them, if all of us have good thoughts, there's something called collective consciousness. So many people think about your wellness. They are not thinking of the body, they are thinking of the consciousness. And possibly that's the way it helps. The aura changes of that man. Because some people are thinking about his consciousness or something. So there is something called collective consciousness. So whatever happened is because of collective consciousness. Actually, we are all interdependent of whatever you are breathing. You see, you are hardly breathing 0.01% of the original molecules. What you are breathing is what everybody else is breathing out. You are breathing in the molecules of Mahatma Gandhi also, and Abraham Lincoln also, and so on. All the queens, all the decorates, everybody, because the molecules that we inhale are dependent on others. We are dependent on others. See, What are we breathing in here? It's not our own molecules, it's molecules of others who are breathing it out. So there is something called a unified consciousness, and that changes. And there is a, if you hear Deepak Chopra, he says there is a certain quantum which, if it comes 25%, there will be world peace. A unified quantum. Everybody has to improve, this means. If most of the people improve, then could be, that has an effect.
I have been suggesting to my cardiologist that, and he agrees also, that now anytime you operate on anybody, especially the bypass operation, so whatever, I think you must sit down for a few seconds, a few minutes, or whatever time, and think and become spiritual, and then only you operate on.
For sure.
Have all your technology at hand. Everything completely.
Every doctor does it,
but
even if he doesn't believe.
That sense of
suppose
mind.
I'm going to do the first surgery, it's complicated. I say, God, please help me so that the result is. Everybody does it. And these are people who don't believe in God, but still they pray to somebody that I should be successful. If you're doing a difficult job, you always do. And so this means there's a hidden spirituality in all of us.
All of us.
Unfortunately, we don't do it all the time. If we do it all the time, then we don't need all these things. Yes. Anything else?
Last question.
Otherwise, can we do 2 minutes of meditation?
Yes.
Yes. I think I'll just 2 minutes. It's a very modified. It's not the total preksha. I think all of you sit straight. And any posture, the back should be straight, that's all. If you are sitting in the back, please come. You can come in the front. Keep your hands in any way you want. It should be relaxed posture. Keep it and just close your eyes. Gently close your eyes. There's a lot of distraction is there. We will start with the distraction here. You see, you are concentrated on the sounds that are coming around you. Some car speeding. Full concentration should be there. So don't think of anything else except the sounds coming. If you are sitting in a garden, maybe a bird is chirping, water is falling, rain is falling, just concentrate on that. There is a door closure, it should be only on sounds and all. This is the way to concentrate. Now we will bring our attention to the tips of the nostrils. Just forget everything else, watch every breath. The concentration should be on the tips of the nostril. When you are breathing in, the breath is a little cold, and when you are breathing out, it's a little warm. So like a chowkidar, a dedicated person, no breath should go without your knowledge. Watch your breath. The breath which is going in is a little cold, coming out. It let it be natural breathing. You don't have to take deep breaths, or the breath may go inside, stop for some time, may come out and stop. Natural breathing. But concentration completely on the tips of the nostril. It's possible your concentration will run away. Bring it back there only. It's very natural for the concentration to go away from the tips of the nostril. So wherever it runs, try to bring it back. Full concentration on the tips of the nostril. Watch every breath. Body steady, eyes gently closed. Watch every breath. Lots of thoughts will come. Don't try to stop the thoughts. Let them come. But don't react. Watch them like a movie. Sometimes a good thought comes, watch it, don't react. A bad thought comes, watch it, don't. Don't try to stop the thoughts. Meditation is a natural phenomenon, it's not difficult at all. Let the natural things happen. But concentration on the tips of the nostril. Thoughts are coming, let them come, but don't react. Sometimes a thought may come, what am I doing? I should stop it now. Don't bother about that thought also. Concentrate on the tips of the nostrils. Full concentration of the tips of the nostrils. Now, who is watching this breath? That is I, the consciousness, because your eyes are closed, somebody else is watching. You are getting in touch with yourself. Practicing it daily for 10 to 15 minutes will make you aware of yourself a little more. But when we don't respond to the thoughts, we are not bringing the mind in, because mind tries to obstruct us. Because we have not kept company with the mind. Only let the thoughts come, but don't react to them. And slowly this is what is going to happen in your life also. A person may talk good things, may talk bad things, this should not affect you. That is what meditation is. Meditation means you can't change the outside things. Sometimes it is snowing, sometimes it is very warm. We have to adjust. Sometimes people talk good things, sometimes they talk bad things. Don't react. This is what meditation is. We can't change outside things, but we can change our own reaction. And that's what we are trying to do. Concentration on the tips of the nostril. Watch every breath. Full concentration there has to be there. If the concentration goes somewhere else, bring it back there. So this is what meditation is all about. That good or bad things, we just don't react to them. And then we always think positive. So when we are concentrating on our tips of the nostril, our concentration improves over a period of time. We are able to solve the problem with full concentration, whatever problem is there. We are better in our profession. We have more creativity. A lot of data is available on this. People who have turned to spirituality or started doing meditation, they have become better doctors, better husbands, better wives, better children, better parents, better colleagues, better human beings. At the moment we go into spiritual consciousness, all the good traits of spirituality come in us. We have no anger. We have no ego. Become blissful. Blissful means permanent happiness. We become pure. We become powerful. So concentration of the tips of the nostril. So we are realizing who am I, concentrating and thinking positive. The question is asked, how long should I do meditation? I always say 24 hours. Whatever you are doing, you should concentrate and think positive. For example, if you are going for a walk, concentrate on walk. Don't discuss politics. Don't discuss your family matters. When you are eating, again you can meditate. Concentrate on the food. Don't discuss the family matters. Don't watch the TV. Full concentration on your eating. And feel that the food is, that you are eating is making you healthy. So it is full concentration. Whenever you concentrate on something, things will go wrong at times. Think positive. Life is like the waves of an ocean. Happiness and unhappiness are part of normal life. If any unhappiness occurs, that's normal. And think positive. So full concentration of the tips of the nostril. You can do it sitting in the car if you have a driver, like in India, or sitting in the office, you get 5 minutes. Just concentrate on the tips of the nostril. Watch your breath. And don't react to the thoughts. You find that over a period of time you can do it for a longer period. Start with 5 minutes, you can go to 10 minutes. Only thing is that see that there is no disturbance, no telephone, no mobile, and you are not disturbed for those 5 or 10 minutes. for a period of time it becomes habit, that you are aware of whatever you are doing. And this is also called mindfulness meditation. You are walking, you are concentrating only on walking, that the exercise that I am doing is improving my heart, it's improving my joints. I'm thinking just of exercise. Food, I am thinking of food. When I am with the family, I am thinking only of the family. My children, my child is the only thing. So full concentration of the tips of the nostrils. We end this by rubbing our hands very briskly. Go on rubbing till they are heated up. And then cover your eyes. Open your eyes very gently. So there is darkness around. Then slowly put the fingers down. Open your eyes. That's all. I think this is a very short glimpse of what meditation is. We start with some